Hello again. Today we are continuing our journey through the Baroque period, and we're going to listen to some more great music, and we're going to talk about how they illustrate the Baroque period just as we did with Vivaldi last class. So again, you need to do your reading and watch the videos that I assigned because the test draws from everything. All right. Does anyone remember the traits that we saw that were pretty consistent in the Vivaldi pieces that we listened to? These are the things that you need to remember for the Baroque period. Number one, unity of mood. An entire movement or section will express one basic mood. And they achieved that through repetition of melodic and rhythmic motives. Consistent rhythmic pulse, reusing those melodic motives. Number two, terraced dynamics, right? Sudden changes in volume. And this is tied to the harpsichord that can't play crescendos or decrescendos. Harpsichord has one volume. Number three, virtuosity. Music is written for instrumentalists and vocalists to show off. Number four, instrumental music has caught up with vocal music in importance, and composers are now asking for specific instruments. Okay, time to shift gears a little bit, and we're going to go to a new form of vocal music that was invented during the Baroque period. Any guesses? Opera, my personal favorite. It is indeed time to look at opera. Okay, opera hasn't been around forever. You may listen to Gregorian chant and think, oh, that's like opera. Nope. Opera was invented around 1600 in Italy by a group called the Camerata, or Fellowship. And they were trying to invent a new vocal style that was modeled on the music of the ancient Greek tragedy. But they only had secondary resources. Just like us, in many cases, they had no idea what it sounded like, so they studied and they made their best guess. And unlike a regular play, everything is sung. This was a totally new idea for them. And it could be a big spectacle with lots of showing off. A fun quote is that, "No good opera plot can be sensible, for people do not sing when they are feeling sensible." You could argue that either way. Now, we've already reviewed the voices, soprano, alto, tenor, bass. We listened to countertenors. So let's talk about some of the elements of opera. First thing, we have an aria, which is a song for solo voice with accompaniment. And an aria naturally stretches a thought or emotion out over time. So I might say a couple of lines of dialogue in a regular play, and I'm now going to spend 5 minutes singing about it. So it stretches things out over time. There's a lot of repetition of text, and it does let the singer show off. Lots of notes. Next element is recitative, which is basically speak singing, right? It's a vocal line that imitates speech. And this is much more pronounced than what we heard in Gregorian chant, which was supposed to sort of mimic speech. So we're gonna listen to a song by Weird Al Yankovic. I never know how to pronounce his last name. He's a comedy artist and he does parodies of songs. And so this parody is pretty much in a recitative style, but it's also a really funny song. So we're going to listen to that, and you can get an idea of this idea of speak singing, right? So let's listen and see what you think.
Sous 7 o'clock in the evening, watching something stupid on TV. I'm zoned out on the sofa when my wife comes in the room and sees me. And she says, is this Behind the Music with Leonard Skinner? And I say, I don't know, say it's getting late, what you wanna do for dinner? She says, I kinda had a big lunch, so I'm not super hungry. I said, well, you know, baby, I'm not starving either, but I could eat. She says, so what do you have in mind? I said, I don't know, what about you? She says, I don't care if you're hungry, let's eat. I said, that's what we're gonna do. But first you gotta tell me what it is you're hungry for. And she says, let me think, what's left in our refrigerator? I said, well, there's tuna, I know. She said, that went bad a week ago. I said, is the chili okay? She said, you finished that yesterday. I hopped up and said, I don't know, do you want to get something delivered? She's like, why would I want to eat liver? I don't even like liver. I'm like, no, I said delivered. She's like, I heard you say liver. I'm like, I should know what I said. She's like, whatever, I just don't want any liver. Well, I was gonna say something, but my cell phone started to ring. Now who could be calling me? Well, I checked my caller ID. It was just Cousin Larry calling for the third time today. My wife said, let it go to voicemail. I said, okay. Where were we? Oh, dinner, right. So what do you wanna do?
All right. Hopefully you enjoyed that. It's a silly song. It really does demonstrate recitative really well. And so there's a whole story he was telling you, right? And this is how the action moves forward in an opera. Recitatives. It's really hard to say that. Recitatives. As a singer, we call them recits or recits, right? But that's where the action is moving along. People are chit-chatting. And then we stop and we contemplate our emotions and we sing about how we feel for however long the aria is. All right. Aria. Recitative. It's a mouthful. Then we have the ensembles. Two or more singers. Duets, trios, quartets, quintets, sextets. The sky's the limit. Honestly, it's a minute and then you get, all of a sudden you're like, and it's a full-blown chorus. Oh, which by the way is the last thing. Chorus is when a crowd sings. And a lot of the time, the chorus tends to comment on the action. So we're going to watch an excerpt of an opera by Claudio Monteverdi, and he is considered the first great operatic composer, and his works are still performed today. His first opera was called Orfeo, which is the Greek tragedy about Orpheus. Remember, they're still very fascinated by Greek mythology, and they're also trying to resurrect a Greek art form that they don't really know what it was like. So the story here is that Orpheus marries Eurydice. She is bitten by a snake in their wedding. She gets taken off to Hades, right? Which is the underworld. And just Greek underworld is not what we consider to be eternal punishment. It has both your eternal reward or your eternal punishment, depending. If you enjoy like the Percy Jackson series, something that I have enjoyed reading very much, then you probably know that already. If you haven't read those and you enjoy reading, you might give them a try. Greek mythology, just giving my plug for Greek mythology, full of great stories, which makes for great opera. Orpheus goes down to the underworld and he sings to the god of the underworld, and the god takes pity on him, says, here, take your wife out of the underworld, but you can't turn around and look at her until you're all the way out. Orpheus can't stand it. Right before they get out, he turns around to look, and she just sort of fades into a wisp, and off she goes. He tries to get back down, but he's weeping too hard to sing, and basically it's a sad ending. So there are versions of this opera where she's resurrected again. So sometimes there's a happy ending. As we watch and listen to this clip, I want you to think about word painting used. So we are going to have a recitative followed by the chorus. Think about word painting.
Mm-hmm. da me partita. Sei da me partita per mai più non tornare ed io rimango. No, no, che se i versi alcuna cosa fanno, andrò sicura più profondi abissi. Rivedere le stelle, o se ciò negherà mio impio destino, rimarrò teco in compagnia.
Hopefully you heard that when he was singing words like abissi, which is abyss, and morte, which means death, he was singing very low tones. When he was singing about stelle and sole, which is the sun and the stars, he was singing very high notes. So some basic word painting there. And the instruments that were accompanying the singers on the recitative portion was a string instrument and the harpsichord. And then once the chorus came in, the whole orchestra started to play. Let's dig into the idea of the harpsichord and a string instrument playing with the solo singer. We're going to go back and look at this a different way. And I want you to pay attention to the sheet music, specifically the accompaniment, and see if it matches up to what you hear.
Partita per mai più non tornare, io rimango. cosa ponno, n'andrò sicura più profondi abissi. Rivedere le stelle, ma se ciò negherà mio impio destino, rimarrò cieco in compagnia di morte.
What do you see playing with him? It's a single line of notes, which is not what we heard. What's going on here? This is called basso continuo or figured bass. And there is a video that I signed on this, so I'm going to move pretty quickly through this, but you can watch that video, rewatch it if you need to. Okay. Figured bass means that we have a single line of notes with little numbers or figures, and the numbers tell us how to build the chord above it. In figured bass, a string instrument or other low instrument like cello or bassoon will play those single notes, and then the harpsichord player is going to look at the figures and make up an accompaniment based on that on the spot. Just like making stuff up. I'm in awe that they could actually do this. So if we look at a basso continuo or figured bass line, and there are no chords in there, we call that an unrealized figured bass. And then once the harpsichord comes up with the part, and maybe we write it down, then that is a realized figured bass. So let's listen to the difference. First, unrealized. Now, a realized figured bass. So definitely different. Again, you have a video covering figured bass. Be sure to watch it because you do need to understand the concept going forward. Figured bass is used a whole lot in opera. So the keyboard players that tend to have that skill usually accompany opera. And they may play it on piano or harpsichord, just depending on what's available. Now, Tu sei morta was a recitative with continuo, right? Basso continuo, we call it continuo. And it's a long one, but that's not a full aria. So we're going to listen to an aria from another famous opera from the Baroque, and the opera is called Dido and Aeneas, and is also based on a Greek myth, another tragic one. And it is a really beautiful aria, and it's famous for something called ground bass. So ground bass is a musical idea in the bass line that repeats over and over while the melody above it changes, which gives unity to the piece. Remember, Baroque period, unity. I want you to keep remembering that. We're going to listen to this with the sheet music and see if you can pick out the repetition. Now let's watch the full scene and think about how this technique, with that repetition, works dramatically.
Thank you.
okay, dramatically, if you think about a spiral of sadness that is pulling the character down. So it's basically like the same thought is just going through her head over and over and over again. And we musically are seeing that. So it's really, really sad. All right. For our last couple of selections, we are going to switch to a different vocal form called the oratorio. The oratorio developed as a means of entertainment during the season of Lent. Operas were prohibited. They were seen as too joyful in what is supposed to be a season of reflection and giving things up in Lent. So they were very similar to opera in the overall sound, but they were not acted out with costumes, sets, scenery, or even a stage. So no movement, no costumes, no set, no scenery, no stage. In fact, they were performed in a church, and they used only sacred topics and, in fact, came straight from biblical text. Probably the most famous oratorio is Handel's Messiah, which has one big section for Christmas and one big section for Easter. We're going to listen to a recitative and aria sung by a tenor. And again, remember, recitative is speak singing. And this one is different because it's accompanied by the orchestra. So we call that accompanied recitative. What we heard in the opera with just the harpsichord is known as a secco recitative. And that just means dry. It's a dry recit, right? So accompanied or dry. So let's go ahead and listen to this. And I want you to pay attention to melismatic singing, very joyful, and word painting. In particular, when he talks about valleys and hills and crooked things made straight. All right, here we go.
Comforting. voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God.
Fantastic piece. And when it's sung well, it's very, very inspiring. Very inspiring. So hopefully you enjoyed that. Okay. We can't talk about Handel's Messiah without going to look at the Hallelujah Chorus. And we're going to look specifically at the musical texture. Let's review. Polyphonic, homophonic, monophonic. When we look at the Hallelujah Chorus, and we're going to look at it with an animated score, I want you to look because there are alternating sections that are homophonic and then polyphonic. Why do we go back and forth? Why wouldn't we just pick one and commit to it? Every time we change from one to the other, it adds an emphasis. Polyphonic sections are joyful and exuberant, and the homophonic sections are very majestic and a little weightier. So let's listen to this and see if you can feel how that change affects it. So hopefully you heard the polyphonic sections. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Very joyful and exuberant, right? He shall reign forever. He shall reign. He shall reign. He shall reign. Very joyful. Then we get into the kingdom of this world is become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. Everyone comes together. Like, I'm just getting chills just thinking about it. I love this piece. I can't get through the end of it without getting choked up when I'm singing it. It's usually pretty fun. I'm like, King of Kings forever and ever. Yeah, that's basically what I do when I sing this with the choir. Not gonna lie. But those sections, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, they just cut straight to your heart because we're not doing that polyphonic interweaving. It's now homophonic. Everyone's singing the same rhythm together, and it really makes a difference. Okay, we are done with the part two of the Baroque. Next time we get together, we're going to talk about the fugue. It's the last thing we're going to discuss in the Baroque period. All right, hope you have a great day, and I will see you in the next video. Bye.